Welcome to the 20th meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Today we continue our evidence taking on the Scottish Government's Public Service Reform Programme, and we hear from, with names etc. hopefully pronounced correctly, we have had some debate at this end of the table, Malcolm Burr, Chief Executive of Common Lane and Aileen Shah, Robert Emmett, Executive Director of Corporate Services at Dundee City Council, and Ian Tough, Head of Corporate Support at East Ayrshire Council. And I welcome you all to this meeting. I tend to allow up to around 75 minutes for the session. If witnesses would like to be brought into the discussion at any point, please indicate to clerks and I can then call you. We have your written submissions, so we'll move straight to questions. And I think the first question will be to Mr. Burr. So let's just start at the beginning, I suppose, Mr. Burr. I mean, one of the things that we've been asking about is sustainable services, and of course, as with the COSER submission, the phrase was used, fair and sustainable funding. So what does fair and sustainable funding mean to you? Bearing in mind, one of the comments I noticed in your report, which is that your local authority, you say, has had the biggest reduction consistently in revenue funding over the last few years. So I wonder if you can talk us through that.
Yes, Chair, happy to do so, and thank you for the invitation to the committee. The Corla has indeed seen the largest pro rata funding reduction in its revenue budgets over the last 10 years, some 15%, and that is all set out in the SPICE analysis of Scottish budgets each year. That's a combination of the funding formula and other factors, but for a small council it means our sustainability in terms of performing our statutory duties, showing community leadership, being an effective advocate for our area is inevitably questionable in future. I think we were all struck in the Highlands and Islands, particularly by Highland Council's Chief Finance Officer's statement at his council's budget meetings in February that Highland Council was no longer sustainable in the medium term. Now, you know, that was a striking statement, and it was there in black and white. Many of us, I think, in local government at the moment could construct a similar argument. You will have seen, Chair, from our submission that a lot of our work, a lot of our answer to this, as well as the more traditional means of using resource more effectively, and no doubt we'll come on to these, is invested in public service reform, particularly single public authority. That, thankfully, is on the move again. But without that, I think there is a real risk in areas like mine, and where there are multiple organisations, each facing significant funding reductions, that we singly become less and less effective, and then the capacity for community leadership and delivery is lost. And very soon, I think, we will be... the services we provide will not be of the same level or standard as we would like.
OK, so what is fair and sustainable funding?
Fair and sustainable funding for us is needs-based funding, and that brings me, in our case, to the Islands Act. I'm sorry to make it a more specific point, but the Islands Scotland Act provides that an island community's impact assessment be made by law for any change to policy, strategy or service, that in our view includes Scottish budgets. So there's that formal side to it. But to answer your question, we need a gradual restoration of funding levels, not in excess of what was there before, but to mitigate some of these reductions. We also, I think, like most councils, seek multi-year clarity. It is very difficult, I think we have to be honest, it is very difficult to undertake strategic planning in an atmosphere of one-year budgets, where you're waiting for the verdict, as it were, every Christmas as to what the allocation will be. And I think that impacts the smaller councils particularly. So sustainable funding in today's straitened times, and we recognise the pressures on Scottish Government too, means sustainable funding means multi-year, at least 2 to 3 year indications, because otherwise we can't plan effectively. Fair funding, I think, means looking at the needs of areas and what is required to run a reasonable level of services in those areas. Part of that assessment has to be that other options which are available to larger authorities, such as outsourcing of services, such as sharing services across boundaries, are simply not available to Islands Councils. There is no market in the Western Isles to undertake refuse collection or waste disposal or leisure services. Likewise, I can't close a leisure centre and hope that the private sector will pick that up, or that customers can travel on a bus to another part of it. If I close a leisure centre, that is that entire island's leisure facilities gone. There are four islands, Lewis, Harris, Uis, Barra. If one of them goes, then that service is taken away for the whole island. So that, I think, genuinely needs to be factored into account. I'm not a fan of special pleading, except where there is evidence to justify it, but it needs to be more nuanced than it is. Sorry for the long answer.
No. I think it was a very comprehensive answer. I mean, I mean, you've touched on a couple of things, obviously, you've mentioned in your submission, for example, you know, you've talked about the need to actually have one kind of single authority. I think that's a significant point. You also talked about the difference between yourselves and others in terms of being able to outsource, and I think that's also significant. I mean, depopulation, I would imagine, has played some kind of part in terms of the reduction in funding also. No one ever seems to want to say how much, I have to say, what fair and sustainable funding is in terms of pounds, shillings and pence, I notice. But do you not accept, though, that, I mean, Ross actually raised this last week, the Scottish Government itself doesn't have multi-year funding, so it's kind of difficult for it to have multi-year funding for those who depend on it when it itself isn't in that position. Is that not a fair comment?
I think that's a very clear difficulty, Chair, but we must rise above these difficulties and at least set indicative budgets for a longer period than we currently do. I mean, that is not, we all recognise circumstances, we all recognise unexpected events, but the share of the Scottish budget which local government attracts has diminished significantly in recent years. I'm the longest serving chief exec in Scotland now, and when I was appointed way back in 2005, it was roughly a third local government, a third NHS, and a third Scottish Government and its business. That's now hugely skewed towards NHS, and I make no comment on that. These are political choices, but there is a consequence of that. And I think a greater balance needs to be restored if we truly recognise the importance of local government services, which are fundamental, and we need... I dare say I hesitate to use the words New Deal because that's on the cards, but we need a number of things. There's lots of them we can talk about. Fiscal empowerment is one, but in the short term, we need greater clarity, and I respect that clarity is not there for Scottish Government either, but we must set indicative budgets or proper planning is impossible because we will be down to single-year solutions, which really means either drastic reductions or redundancies among staff very soon. That is what Highland was saying, and I endorse that.
Although, Mr. Emmett, all evidence suggests that even with 1 year, even when you know where funding is for only 1 year, medium to long-term planning is still extremely important. Would you not agree with that?
So, absolutely, I think that, as we've made, I mean, if you look back, certainly in my experience, we've been making savings, you know, most of my career, it would be safe to say, particularly since 2008, we've been under financial pressure. So it's been important that we plan ahead. I suppose it's become harder to do things and it takes more time to do things. So the types of changes that we are looking at now are taking longer to do. We have to be planning ahead and looking at what's happening and what's happening with our cost base. So some of our costs are easy to project going forward. You'll be aware inflation in the last period has made a substantial impact on the nature of planning. So the impact of the costs on you know, things like PFI contracts, energy and staffing in particular, make that have increased the level of uncertainty that we have got going forward. So we're looking forward. Our projections that we considered when we set the budget in February were that Dundee would have to save almost £30 million over the next few years based on the best information that's available to us. And we have to plan. So we have to plan so we're in a position to set a budget when we come through to next year. And any proposals we're taking forward, we've got to make sure that we're consulting on and we're assessing the impact of them in advance. So I think that planning is important, though that planning might change. So it's based on a set of assumptions. And I think the more certainty that councils have got about what the thinking is, and we see some of the thinking from the UK government, but not all of it, and what the thinking is within the Scottish government. So the medium-term financial plan gives us a steer on that as to what we might expect and what plans we might put in place to address that.
Yes, I mean, in terms of one of the things you're obviously implementing, as indeed everyone else is to a degree, is digitalisation. So, I mean, what kind of time period are you hoping to deliver digitalisation over in terms of what you're hoping to deliver? And I'm just wondering if you're working with other local authorities about this, because when I read reports about local authorities and their work on digitalisation, it seems that everyone's beavering away. I'm not sure what kind of level of cross-local authority working there is. So, for example, we could have you know, similar types of systems being implemented, you know, possibly economies of scale, etc. So I'm just wondering where you are on that.
So I think it's a multi-year programme. So like I was saying, as we move towards those things, it's going to take time to do. So we're doing a piece of work with a neighbouring authority looking at how we can, what we might be able to do in terms of sharing services. Can we share a system? Can we share a team? Does that help us with resilience? Does that save us any money? Does that make us more efficient in the process we are doing? And I think we've been on a journey, as I said, over the last 10 plus years about how we can make things more efficient. That's the next area to look at. I think, you know, my own view is that we've got a lot of public bodies in Scotland who are repeating things, who have got their own payroll systems, they've got their own ledgers, they've got their own directors of finance, dare I say it. And what can we do to streamline that process and make that process more digital? I think there is space we could be in there. COSLA's digital office is trying to do some work around that. It's hard synchronising big public authorities into the same system. So if we're looking at, you know, I think of Fife Across the Water, who've got a big ERP system that they're invested in, synchronising that with what we're doing would be quite a big, you'd have to plan to do it and have a long-term challenge. And would the providers then be looking to charge you double for moving into that space? So I think there are challenges around that, but that's the direction we're going in. We're looking at tests of change. Can we work collaboratively? Can we focus on where we are with back office services? The only thing I think I would add to that, Camina, is that digitalisation is only part of the service. So if I look at all of our management costs, they're about 1% of the business. Most of our costs of delivering services are tied up in frontline staff and what they are doing on the front line. So digitalisation is part of the agenda, which will continue to improve efficiency. It's not going to, along with other things, it will help bridge some of the gaps we've got in terms of trying to reduce resources and streamline things.
Yes, I mean, obviously, I think staff is always going to be a major component, if not the major component, in all local authorities, no matter how digitalised you become. And I'm just wondering if you see digitalisation as an ongoing thing, or is there a kind of goal at the end of that where you feel as if you'll be able to, you know, reach the optimum service delivery?
So I think it'll be ongoing. I think that if you think about how technology's evolved, if you think about how virtual meetings became a thing virtually overnight, and that's transformed how people can do business and what people can do. So I think we are still on a journey. We are some way off technology replacing people in things like care services. But if you think about some of the developments in AI that we've seen in the last few months, how do we capture and take advantage of those? So I suppose we don't know what's around the corner that we're going to be able to make use of to do what we do better. And if you think, you know, in the education space, the opportunities and the information and the technologies available have surely got opportunities to think about how we are delivering services and how we can deliver services differently, and particularly in remote areas where access to services is a challenge.
And Mr. Tuff, I mean, you've also got quite a lot of detail in terms of your digitalisation strategy, and I mean, you're hoping to invest in digitalisation, but to be able to recoup that ultimately, have you got any kind of time period over which you think you'll be able to recoup the cost of digitalisation, or is it always going to be something where you're never quite able to manage that?
Our digital strategy is a five-year strategy, but that won't be the end of it. At that five-year period, I think that is a longer journey for us. Certainly, recouping the investment is something we've really promoted, and we've actually set aside, and I think it's also within the papers you've got, is for our strategic plan that we set last year and our budget that goes along with that, the medium-term financial strategy, we've got a £3 million investment fund. So that's really to incentivise some of that return on investment, so to have money up front that services can then use to get that return on investment. So that's very deliberate to address the point you make there about just how sustainable some of that innovation can be. So we're really encouraged by having our digital strategy, which builds on, really by necessity, what we had to do through the worst of the pandemic, moving so much of our transactional work online, helping communities still to engage, and that was really successful for us, and we're wanting to build on that. So, okay, it was by necessity, but actually it's put in place now the foundations for what we think is an improvement journey for us that we won't get to in 5 years, but we'll certainly make inroads towards where we want to get to.
I mean, and one of the things you've said in your submission is that monthly online transactions have increased from 1,500 pre-pandemic to over 25,000 monthly, reducing paper handling, improving processing times and transforming service delivery. So how does that work for people who are not digitally included?
So alongside that, and again, it's a theme within the digital strategy, is about inclusivity and making sure that those who are furthest away from having that access, there are other ways for them to do that. So we've examples of providing equipment to communities and schools, to families. We've got a digital access network that is really about identifying where there are gaps and addressing them. So while we want to shift as much of this because there are efficiencies, we also recognise that not all parts of our communities will be able to embrace that just as much as other parts. So it's very much a theme of the digital strategy that we want to embrace those efficiencies, but we also want to make sure we don't leave anyone behind as well.
Okay, thank you. And I mean, one of the things that caught my eye in terms of your submission, Mr. Tuff, was the fact that you have transferred 58 assets to community ownership and operation, because obviously the rationalisation of estates is an important part of the form agenda. And I'm just wondering how successful those have been, if some of them had to hand them back, or are they all managing to work effectively, albeit one or two, or perhaps more than one or two, will be needing some continued support from the local authority. How is that actually working, and is it something that you believe that other local authorities could learn from in terms of East Ayrshire's model?
No, thanks, Kavina. And yes, so that has been a success for us, and that's over a period of 10 years. I think actually we're up to low 60s, 61 I think it is now, asset transfers. So we have had some that have been more challenging than others, but we've also had some fantastic successes. We've got a former high school in Kilmarnock, that's Kilmarnock Academy, is now part of a performing arts centre stage, who have got a fantastic reputation. They've been able to draw down resources that the council couldn't do to invest in that facility. So there are a range of examples from very small CAT transfers right through to the very large ones, like the centre stage at Kilmarnock Academy. So they've been fantastically impressive. They are very much owned by the communities. It is their facility, and they run them. We provide some support at the start to get them up and running, but we've yet to have any that have returned the asset to us. But we know that there are still more to come as well. So that journey of 10 years on asset transfers was very much part of our transformation strategy work as well prior to, so that was from 2012-13 right through to 2021. So the service that we created to deliver the CAT transfer, our vibrant communities service, has just celebrated its 10th anniversary as well. And cat transfers is one part of their success, but there are many more. It's a different way, a different model of supporting our communities, and that's been a bigger success for us.
I mean, one of the things I've talked about for many years, actually, is about shared best practice with local authorities. Is that something, then, you think other local authorities should actually be looking at in terms of how East Ayrshire does this? Or, you know, and what do you feel you could learn from other local authorities in terms of how they deliver services, for example?
On your first point, Convener, then, yes, we know and we've had approaches from other councils because we've been out promoting what we do, and certainly the chief officers, the team that have been delivering our vibrant communities. We just won a Municipal Journal Award last week as well. So we've got a bit of a national platform for our vibrant community service, and so we have had approaches from others to see how we do. But yes, we are also keen to look at what is good practice in other areas that we are working in, and to see what else is happening. So one of the areas where is a priority for us ties in a wee bit with the digital that you mentioned, was just how we manage data and more of a strategic approach to how we manage data. So we are actively looking to see what is a benchmark, a good practice example out there of that, and we're spreading that net wide. It's not just Scottish authorities we're looking at, but elsewhere. And the other part, again, going back to our transformation strategy, we had some cultural change work through. We developed what we call FACE principles, and that again was very much based on best practice that we found in other parts of the country. So we're very open to seeing what else is out there, but we're also proud of some of the stuff we've taken forward ourselves. Chair. Thanks.
Thank you. And Mr. M, looking at Dundee's submissions, one of the questions that was asked was about the organisation's plans to seek and deliver on the Scottish Government's three strategic priorities, which were set out. But what I've noticed in Dundee's response is that you've said that reducing child poverty and inequalities and income is education, but you haven't really expanded on that to really see how you're actually going to deliver on that. It's just really a line. I'm just wondering if you can expand on that a wee bit for us, please.
So I'm happy to share with the committee the details of the city plan, which goes into more detail on what we're doing. But a lot of the focus of the city's work is around preventative and investment in early years. So I suppose to a certain extent that reflects, in my mind, the priorities of the government, which have been around investing in early years and giving people the best start. And that also comes through, I think, in the investment in staffing, which where you see that the growth in staffing across the council has been through the Children and Families Service and through the and in teaching over recent years, whereas the areas where efficiencies and reductions have been made have been across the other services. I think one of the challenges for us as we go forward is that is such a priority for us. And if we think then again about, so there is a place for digital in the classroom, but a lot of the work that's needed within schools to give people the best start is around resources in the classroom and in the early years setting. So that's been a priority for us, and that also comes through, I think, when we're setting our budget and we're looking at what are the areas that we are focusing on and that we are protecting as a council going forward. I don't know if that helps, Convener. Mm-hmm. I think I'm not the expert on early years. You'll appreciate we are doing a piece of work across the council at the moment, which is looking at positive destinations and how we can collaborate with our partners to give people the best start. So when they leave school, where are they ending up? What opportunities they've got, and what are the things that are influencing whether or not they have a positive outcome and end, from there after they leave school, compared with if they have a less successful outcome. And that comes back, and what we're seeing is that comes back to attendance at school and support in school. So, you know, if you think about where you want to end up, how far back do you go in the process to make sure that people have the best start going forward? And that's one of the things that comes out of that, I think, and certainly my view is that there are, again, a number of bodies involved in that. So again, we've got different agencies working around the table, not necessarily all with the same objectives going forward. So that's our public sector landscape is quite complex, I think, is what I would say in that. Mm-hmm. And just to say the last thing, I suppose, reflects a combination of pressures and circumstances. So we're seeing in the last year, our biggest financial pressure is from placements for children and making sure that we find the best way to look after people who have got challenging and complex circumstances. And individual placements can be very expensive, and we need to find the ways to make sure that we prevent those coming to fruition, and we actually find the best outcomes again for children in our community. So that can be a very expensive, and is for Dundee a very expensive area of for the council in terms of resources. And what we're working on at the moment is how can we best look after people in our local community, which is where they're best served, and that's also often the most efficient way. A lot of these things link in, convener, so that also takes us back to community wealth and how we looking after and retaining and managing resources in our own communities rather than at a distance from us. Apologies, I've gone over a lot of ground there.
No, not at all, actually. I'm just going to ask you one more thing, then I'll move on to Mr. Byrne and open out to the rest of the session. And that's just about the 12 questions that we asked. I was intrigued to note, and I'm going to be asking Mr. Byrne about this in a minute, that three of the questions, the response was not applicable. So I'll ask you about that, the reason for that in a minute, Mr. Byrne. But in terms of Dundee's submission, you didn't respond to questions 10 and 11, and 10 was one of the ones that Mr. Byrne didn't respond to. And question 10 was, what level of support and guidance has your organisation been given by the Scottish Government to deliver the efficiencies and plans necessary for your organisation, and how adequate has this been? So Mr. Tuff did respond to that. I'm just wondering why Dundee didn't respond to that. What's your view of that? Do you feel you're not getting the guidance and support? Or?
Not at all. I suppose that as local government's a tier of government with responsibility for discharging its duties, so I think that we try through COSLA and through our own politicians to work closely with the government on implementing and responding to consultations on policy direction. So I think that, if I go back to your previous question, I suppose I would say what the council is aspiring to do is very closely aligned to what the government is aspiring to do, and I think there's a local aspect to that in terms of what's right for Dundee. In my experience, when we've needed guidance and support on particular aspects, then the government has been there to provide it and to engage with it. But I suppose as a autonomous local authority, then it's for us to make decisions about within the parameters that we're given about how we deliver services.
Okay, thank you for that. And Mr. Byrne, so you know what I'm going to be asking you? In terms of question 9, the question there is, how, if at all, is your organisation working collaboratively with other public sector organisations to produce joint service reform plans for the public body landscape and use of resources for submission to the Scottish Government late this year? Now, the reason that I was surprised about not applicable is this, because you talk about a single islands partnership, and I would have thought that you would be working with the other public bodies on the island, for example, NHS, etc. I'm sure you do work closely with that. So I'm just wondering if you can give us a wee response to those questions now.
Yes, convener, happy to do that. I genuinely think that's caught up in our other answers on public service reform and the local outcome improvement plan and the community planning partnership. We probably answered it rather literally, in the sense that after all local governance reform, all public service reform was effectively suspended during the COVID period, and we're now delighted to see that's being reactivated, and one of the first things we did post-COVID was to invite the then Deputy First Minister to talk to us about single public authority and public service reform, not as a good thing in itself, but also as part of financial strategy. So I think that's caught up there. I mean, we have an active community planning partnership. It tends to focus on specific pieces of work, but its overarching strategy is about retention and growth of population. That is everything for us, and the population has remained stable. And the projections aren't good, but one has to watch the projections too, because they've been quite inaccurate over the years. The population is stable, but it's not good in terms of working age population retention, and that's common to rural Scotland. So that's everything for us. That's the focus of the community planning partnership. But I would hope that the answer to that question is caught up elsewhere in the submission.
Okay, the time's against us. I won't push that any further. But thank you for that. And I'm just going to open up the session to colleagues. First person to ask questions, John, followed by Douglas.
Thanks very much, Convener. I mean, just maybe to pursue that a little bit with yourself, Mr. Burr, you're talking about now, is it a single island's partnership or authority? Because in my mind, partnership would mean you keep umpteen different bodies, but you work together more closely. An authority would suggest you come down to one organisation which would run the council, the NHS and everything else.
It's an authority. It recognises, though, that there has to be... people did not join NHS, for example, to work for local government. That NHS, for example, has its own remit, its own clinical priorities. That's not for an elected authority to manage directly. So our model, and that's public record, although we will need to, and we'll be delighted to, update it now that the review of local governance is back on track. It recognises there will be a National Health Service within that, but what it is saying is that the resource available to the Western Isles, how that is distributed, how that is managed, how delivery of it is structured, should be through one elected authority, which is the model in many other parts of Europe, it must be said, Scandinavia.
So do we have to have a National Health Service that is the same all over the country? So you've got a health board in Glasgow. Does that mean we have to have a health board in the Western Isles? Or is there... Because, I mean, we get raised all this time, you know, there's a postcode lottery, it's different here and there, but it seems to me it has to be different here and there.
Yes, I don't think there has to be a health board in the Western Isles. There have to be agreed national health outcomes in the Western Isles. How these are delivered, I think, has to be as much as possible in, for and in support of the islands that they serve. I mean, there may be different outcomes based on different needs, but there is absolutely room within a single island authority model for NHS to do what it does and has to do and should be doing within that model with its own employees. But it is the wider resource. At the moment, we have, frankly, too many organisations serving 27,000 people. A further impetus, if any were needed for this work, was National Care Service. Not, I should say, about the outcomes and the aims of National Care Service, but the structural issues which would impose a third public sector body with a chief executive and all the rest of the apparatus, necessary though that is, serving 27,000 people. So if anything promoted the need for public service reform, even on grounds of efficiency alone, to say nothing of democracy and financial strategy and outcomes, it was that. So
okay.
It is an authority, not a partnership. Right. I think a partnership we have a partnership already. I mean, we work constructively, but partnerships do not solve the amount of money and resource tied up in structures,
right.
And they can't.
Okay,
because
I might come back to you afterwards, but sure. Ayrshire, I mean, we had the health board in, and, you know, there's one health board for Ayrshire, as I understand it, but three councils and three HSCPs. So if you just look at that, that's seven bodies. Could we cut that down? I mean, I think the health board would quite like just one HSCP for the whole of Ayrshire.
Yes, they probably wouldn't. Maybe Claire gave that evidence. I'm not sure if she said that. But and you could say the same. So in terms of the police division, that covers the three councils as well, but it's one same as the fire and rescue regional. So yes, there are opportunities within there to declutter some of that. But actually, in practice and through our partnership arrangements, that's pretty much seamless. We don't see that there are any barriers in there because the three councils work into a single health authority there. Our partnership, in fact, we just done a self-assessment of how productive our partnership has been in it, and it scored really highly from all partners who see actually that the work that we do, and this has went back as far as 1996 when the reorganisation happened, that partnership has been built up and is a real strength for us. So actually the lines on the map might actually show there's one health board, there's three health and social care partnerships, three councils, etc. But in terms of delivery, we think we've worked to a point where the partnership work is really effective. And so, yes, there are opportunities within that. In fact, we share a road service with South Ayrshire Council. So East Ayrshire and South Ayrshire have a single road service. So there are opportunities within Ayrshire, but broader than that, that we look to make the most of. If I think as well about other shared services, we have a shared corporate fraud team across the three councils, three internal audit facilities. So there are opportunities, but to answer your question directly, then yes, I think we can and will be doing more around all of that.
Because you mentioned the police, and we had the police at committee, and one of the things they said was that the really radical reform of taking all the police separate boards and putting them into Police Scotland would not have happened unless there was a real drive from the centre. And so I'm just wondering, around the areas of local authorities, HSCPs, you know, when you look at reform, are you really just looking at tweaking what is there, or would you really look at, would you ever consider a merger with another council?
I don't think anyone can ever write off any opportunity, but as I said, at the moment our partnership arrangements are such that we are really effective, really productive. We've got real challenges in our communities, but we're determined, and we've got a shared outcome agreement with those partners, with police, with fire, with health, etc. So we're all heading in the same direction in terms of outcomes. So the structural arrangements, how we do that, I think is a secondary issue.
But so they don't really matter so much?
Well, for us, I mean, we do blur those lines, because it's about the providing services, providing better outcomes to our communities. And at the moment, we are trying to do that within the current structural arrangements, and it's working for us. We have challenges. We've got some of the most deprived areas in Scotland, within East Ayrshire and North Ayrshire. So we have our challenges, but the structural issues are not getting in the way at the moment of us providing services.
I mean, Mr. Emmett, you've got a slightly different situation. It's a city, but you've still got... I mean, we started off with the health board and the council, and now we've got the health board and the council and the HSCP, or the Integrated Joint Board. So in a sense, the landscape has become more complicated, has it?
I think we have what's important is about focusing on the outcomes. So from a elected councillor perspective, I think you're thinking about, from Dundee, what are we doing for my community, for my inheritance? And it's interesting, you know, if you think of the Outer Hebrides and you think of 27,000 people and you think of 150,000 people in Dundee, and the fact we've got three councils and one, you know, the Tayside Health Board. So it is more complex. Could you have one council? Would that be more efficient? So I think there are efficiencies. Would you lose some of the democratic accountability? Then you might, because what people are focused on, and I think if you were in Angus and Perth, you might be concerned about losing some of your identity and being a bit swamped by the city. I think you're right about radical reform. I think that if you think about where businesses went and where places like Scottish Water went, they centralised and they nationalised and they streamed, and the banks have done. They've taken everyone out. They're all in the centre. So there is an issue if you live in Lewis and Harris about jobs being sucked down out of the islands and the rural places, because you can deliver a service more efficiently out of it. So as councils, we're at the heart of our communities, trying to, you know, build wealth in the communities, provide jobs in the communities. But you know, we've got in Scotland, I think, 10 assessor boards and 4 assessors are carried out in-house. Do we need all of those bodies? Could that all be streamlined? I think the challenge is that radical reform requires strong leadership, and it requires a direction, and this is what we are going to do. So the centralisation of police has given us probably a more efficient and coherent approach. Would you have got that while you had all the police authorities? No. Have you lost something in terms of local accountability for police services? I think you probably have a bit. Those are things to politically weigh up about how we want to deliver services. But I suppose we shouldn't be afraid. We need to be thinking about our outcomes. So how is this helping address, to go back to what the committee was saying, how is this helping to address child poverty? Do we need these bodies, or are they acting as barriers? Have we got too many leaders and not enough people on the ground doing things? Accepting that it's not, you know, for us it's 1% of costs to management. So actually you're not talking about a big bulk of costs. But if you could save half a percent of that still a contribution in terms of some of the challenges and putting resources where they're needed?
Okay, thanks. I think that's my time, so...
I think Mr. Burr wanted to come back in.
Thank you, Convener. In terms of back office, though, it is still a significance. There is a lot invested in structural delivery that I think could, on a local basis, be successfully merged. It's all about looking at the best solution, I think, for local areas. But what heartened me most about the recent revival of the review of local governance was the involvement of NHS in it, because I think there is genuinely a difficulty for non-elected bodies in participating in discussions which might suggest their own change or even demise. They're usually there with a statutory purpose and a board and a very clear mission. They don't really have the power or authority to do that. Local government can make these suggestions because it's government, just as this Parliament and Scottish Government can. But they have to be, other organisations have to be enabled, encouraged through leadership to be part of that debate. Otherwise, it's genuinely easy for them to say, we can't be part of this. You do what you want, but we can't be part of it because we have a statute and a mission and a commission.
Yes. I mean, your population is quite small, and I mean, I love the Western Isles, going there and so on, but, I mean, does there come a point when you just don't have enough people to have your own council and you should just go in with Highland?
I genuinely don't believe so, and this isn't self-interest here. The days of the Western Isles being managed from Dingwall in the case of Lewis and from Inverness in the case of the rest were not happy days in terms of service provision, and indeed when Cornyn and Yillon, as it then was formed in 1975, some of the road conditions, the housing conditions were among the poorest in Scotland. So we are also a natural unit. We are an islands area. I think to merge the council with a mainland authority would not be good for the islands.
Okay, I'll not be pushing that. I was just being devil's advocate. Thanks, Convener.
Thank God you're not pushing that then, John. Let's say, okay, so next colleague to ask a question will be Douglas and followed by Michael.
Thanks, Convener. And it's really to go back on something that Mr. Emmett said right at the start. Really sort of got my interest was about back office services. Maybe there's more scope for that to be shared across all 32 local authorities. Can you give me a bit more idea of what you're thinking is possible around that, Robert?
So I think if you look at some of the functions that we carry out, so if you think about rates collection, for example, we're all collecting rates. We're following broadly national policy and legislation. We're using similar systems, similar approaches to the work that we are doing. So you could potentially have a single national function collecting rates in Scotland. Now, some of my colleagues might not like that idea, but that might be a more effective way of delivering a service for Scotland. Now, it's not going to save, you know, an enormous amount of sum of money, but if you think about the IT support for that, the technical support, the development, etc., that goes with it and allows you to focus on, you might have different policies in different areas, but you could still have a similar system. Now, it's challenging because we're all at different, 32 people all doing, councils all doing slightly different things at the moment. So that's where I was talking about strong leadership. If we want to make progress on those things, there has to be a real push to do those things. The rewards aren't going to solve the problem. They're only going to contribute to helping it. And I suppose there are other things. The other one I just perhaps highlight is the scientific services. So Tayside's Dundee is one of four councils that run a public analyst function that is four across the country. They would be much better run, in my mind, as a national part of a national function rather than as an adjunct to a council. And it's important, and it's an important service that we have in Scotland, but it's not one that is well suited to being run by some councils and not by others. So there is territory there. It's hard. Collaboration is hard, and I think councils have slimmed down over recent years. So the capacity and the pace at which we can take change, we need to look at how we can invest in delivering transformation. So how do we get those changes to happen along with all the other things that councils are busy doing is also a challenge for us. But I personally believe there's opportunities for us there to move some of that forward. And it's nothing new. It's been those types of things have been talked about for a decade or more, probably since Christie.
And do you think we can go a step further and look at, you know, some functions as a whole, potentially finance, potentially HR, IT? Do you think there's scope for maybe a centralised unit for that functions that can then provide services to each of the 32 local authorities?
So I think there is, as long as we don't... There's two bits, I suppose, not to lose sight of them. And the first point is around where the jobs are. So I think if you're a council, and certainly in the islands, where if you were to say we're going to centralise the payroll function in Dundee, then that's not going to be popular. But virtual working in the way we're working now means you could potentially have a national agency that has outreach offices and we can do things better. So I'm very much thinking about how could we take advantage of some of those things and maintain our focus on what's our priority. So our priority is not employing people to run a payroll, but obviously paying our staff is important. It's about the outcomes that are in our plans around, you know, poverty and economic development and net zero and things. How do we focus resources on those? I'm not saying it's easy, because I think all the easier things have probably been addressed and we've looked at them. So the things, you know, joining up and collaborating are harder. So like I said, I was saying earlier on, we're doing a piece of work at the moment with the neighbouring authority, looking at what can we do, what are the opportunities to do things collaboratively on a test basis to see whether we can go further with that. Not that it'll be the answer, but it'll be part of the answer.
And Ian Malcolm, do you think that's a possibility that should be looked at?
I think we have to look at all possibilities openly, but we have to do it on the basis that there is genuine equity, not just equality of opportunity. For example, there are hard-to-fill posts now in, say, internal audit. There's a shortage of internal auditors. Would a national service be an answer to that? It might be. But we have, thankfully, moved from the idea of centralisation of people and services in say, a warehouse somewhere in central Scotland delivering to the whole country, to the fact you can be in Stornoway or Uist or Barra and deliver an internal audit service to other councils. And it must be any development of that kind, and I think we have to be open to new things, particularly where there's a service gap. That has to be sensitive to all areas of Scotland and to provide an opportunity for people in all areas of Scotland to be part of that service without having to move or be lured to a central location. Mm-hmm.
I'd also had the opportunity to see some of the evidence that's been presented to the committee, and I did notice, I think it was Audit Scotland, provided some information about where the reductions in budget have been across the country, and one of them, which showed the corporate services or the support services, actually was a greater reduction there than other parts. And I suppose the issue there then is the capacity within those services then to deliver that change, that shared service, that collaboration. So usually those are the services that would provide the IT infrastructure or the HR or the management systems that support all of that. So if councils are actually reducing the amount of resource that they have in there, and it becomes even more challenging then to deliver that transformational change or those collaborations or those shared services. So that approach would require more investment again to be able to do that effectively.
But I guess, you know, the point that was initially made when we're talking about maybe a central pool of people, it doesn't mean it's centralised and could actually mean more people working in remote areas. It could be to our advantage. And I guess that would cut out duplication, would cut out costs. And then, you know, because that's what the whole public sector reform is about, is to reduce the costs. So, you know, I think you mentioned right at the start, Robert, about ERP systems, for example. You know, is that still taking place where there's duplication across all 32 local authorities? And should that really be? And how do we change that?
So I think it is challenging. I mean, all councils will have their own ledger and their own systems for doing things. And personally, I think there is an opportunity there, but it does require really strong leadership. It requires, if you like, what would you call it, like a burning platform, a real push.
Mandated then.
A push to do. That's a difficult question. I think maybe to bring around some of those changes, and if you think about some of the changes in the police, you have to have some direction and not too much opportunity. Be careful what I'm saying here, but I think if you're going to bring about change, it needs someone to be saying we can do this better, that we can demonstrate that we can provide better services to the public, and we've got to be really careful that there aren't people with vested interests trying to protect the status quo for some reason and not looking at the bigger picture about what we need to be focusing our resources on, because it's not running systems. That's not why we're here. Mm-hmm. And that, if we keep that in the front of our mind, then you say, well, why wouldn't we? And there are challenges because, you know, everyone's on different systems. Can we harmonise everyone? Even if we tell everyone, how long is that going to take to do? There are some, you know, one of the best things that COSLA introduced was the My Job Scotland portal, where everyone advertises their jobs in the same place. So that was a quick win. And because it was a new service, it was easier to say, well, we won't all develop this, we'll all just use this. So I think almost all councils buy into that service, and there isn't really any debate about it. So it's just the best thing to do. So that's where we want to be. This is the best thing to do.
Mm-hmm. But I guess for a new system, it's easier. As you said, if you looked at having a finance system, everyone was going to be using the same finance system, would there be difficulties around, well, hold on, I want to protect what I've got in each local authority?
I suppose there shouldn't be. People should be thinking about, how do I serve my council best? And you know, councils have all got their own unique aspects about the services they deliver, but a lot of the back office functions, there's an efficient way to pay an invoice. It doesn't vary depending on whereabouts you are in the country. So that's where we should be making sure the transactional processes are as efficient as possible and as digital as possible, to go back to what we were talking about before. Can I do things digitally? Why is it different to apply for council tax in one council and another? Some investments probably needed to bring about some of that change and say, how can we do it? How can we do it better? But instead of 32 councils developing an online solution, have we got one council? And perhaps it does need some, it needs very strong leadership, I think, to bring about that level of change, I suppose.
So when it comes to online solutions just now, do you each have the autonomy to, let's think of parking permits, probably doesn't affect everyone here, parking permits, for example, can you each go and develop your own system to put that online, or is there some guidance from the centre, or how does it work?
Their own decision about how they thought they wanted to provide a service locally. So if it was, you know, applying for a permit for, I don't know, a garden waste bin or something. Now, some councils are signed up through is it MyGov Scotland? So there is a common platform for sign-in. You can have one account and you can access services across different councils. But not everybody is signed up to that. So that's an optional thing rather than a mandatory approach.
Because I guess when it comes to digital strategies that we spoke about earlier, you know, the reason that saves money in the long term is to put everything online and to reduce the amount of staff you have, I guess, dealing with a sort of manual process. So in terms of headcount for each of your local authorities, have you estimated the impact that your digital strategy is going to have amongst or on your workforce reduction?
I don't think we've quantified that. Our workforce strategy would be where we would see the connection between our digital ambitions and the impact on our workforce, but we have the digital strategy as it stands doesn't have within it a target for reducing. It has ambitions around efficiency, it has ambitions around cost saving, etc., but doesn't quantify what that would mean for workforce. The workforce strategy in its most general terms is where we would expect to see that direction.
So in terms of your cost savings from your digital strategy, what sort of costs does that save if it's not people cost?
Well, it also provides us with an opportunity for redeployment of staff into other areas, and that was the experience through the pandemic when, as I said earlier, by necessity we moved a lot of that activity online, and it freed up resource to do other things, to support communities, to be actually physically in communities in some respects as well, dealing with all of the various grant applications that were then being processed. So it wasn't so much a reduction, it was more that it was an opportunity to relocate, to put the resource where it was needed.
Okay. Last question I had, Convener, was around multi-year budgets. I'm just trying to work out, what would that actually mean for local councils? Because when I was a councillor, Yes, we didn't know exactly what we're going to have for the next couple of years, but we had a pretty good idea. So what do you think that multi-year budget will give you that you don't have just now?
I think because the financial situation of councils is now so precarious that it is different, perhaps, from previous years. We have projections at the moment which are quite alarming in terms of their reach. I mean, for example, and we talked about headcounts a moment ago, I mean, I have been managing a reduction in headcount in the Corlett over the last 12 years, and that has reduced from about 1,900 full-time equivalent posts to 1,600 now. Now, that's about 500 jobs. That's about 500 people. That's of significance to the economy. So I think the type of planning we need to do now to take account of these projections, and that is why certainty is required. Some services are now so marginal that a sudden reduction beyond projections could put some of the non-statutory services particularly, I think, in some jeopardy. And unless we tie this up with public service reform, which is partly looking at costs, but is really about the retention of a strong public sector in each locality, in my view, unless multi-year budgets are part of that, I don't think we can do it very effectively, or as effectively.
So what would you like to see? Would you like to see the exact sum that you're going to get for the next 3 years, or would you like it tied to the inflation rate? Because if you look at the last year, you're probably getting more than you probably expected to get 2 years ago, but that's been eaten away by the pay deals and everything else. So I guess I'm trying to work out what certainty you would like to see.
I appreciate that, and I go back to comments which are fair that Scottish Government too is subject to 1 year budgets. But I'm looking at it practically. My council's revenue budget about 10 years ago was about 120 million. It's now 102. I'm not expecting that to be restored overnight, but I am looking for some kind of indication that it will at least keep pace with real inflation, that commitments which government seeks to have us deliver will be absolutely fully funded, and that there will be, preferably, as part of a deal with local government, a recognition that public service reform is not going to be delivered overnight, advanced though we are along that route, and there needs to be some stability for the next 2 to 3 years while we look at delivering a more efficient public sector locally. And as Robert Emmett said, that is quite complex because it will be different in the Western Isles from Dundee. But the principles will be the same if they're outcome-focused, if they're focused on keeping a strong public service in a community that has capacity for community leadership. That's what my biggest fear in all this is, that we lose collectively our capacity for leadership in our communities and to be effective advocates for our community and to deliver effective change, as well as looking after people and doing what we're meant to do.
Robert, did you want to?
I suppose just to say, I think indicative figures would help planning for councils. So you know, the UK government produces indicative figures periodically about these are the next few years, this is what it's looking like. And I think having an idea that, I think we all accept circumstances change. Inflation, where we are now with inflation, wasn't predictable before COVID. So we're in a more unusual period. But actually saying this isn't what you can expect to get next year if things stay the same. And there will be changes, and I think we all accept there'll be political decisions and political policies that will come through, and some of them might come through relatively later in the day. If you look at the public information that's available about next year's budget, it's difficult to work out where we're going to go. So we're trying to we've just started thinking about next year, but at the moment we've got the medium-term plan, which indicates there's about £1 billion gap, but not how it's going to be addressed. And so we are trying to judge what the savings we might have to find and where that's going to go. And why I'm particularly conscious of it, I suppose, is we don't want to have a discussion about cutting services that we don't need to cut. That's just going to create alarm and discontent amongst what we're doing. We need to have some idea of what can we expect and what should we be doing, and then decisions about, well, where we might be investing or disinvesting and where we might be focusing on priorities can follow that. I think that there's always going to be a caveat that circumstances might change, and COVID amply demonstrates that.
And you might have some flexibilities coming down the line. I'm thinking the workplace parking levy and the tourist tax potentially coming down the line. Do you see that as ways of plugging your budget just now, or just... I always thought previously it was intended for additional funds, but do you see this now as changed to really just to keep the lights on?
So I think in Dundee, I don't think either of those are going to make a significant implication. I think that the tourist tax, certainly if you look at the councils who probably have the biggest return from that, are spending significant amounts of money on services for tourists. So Highland usually stands out as the most one. But if you look at the impact of, you know, tourists and the success of that, some of the advertising they've done and the number of visitors they've got, the costs of servicing those will, I think, probably drown out the additional revenue that you might get from a tourist tax. We're not expecting it to be quite such a significant. Maybe I'm underestimating the popularity of Dundee after the big weekend, but not such a significant levy. More of an extra, and likewise with parking levy, that's not something that we're looking at as a council at the moment. I suppose it's fair to say that in terms of local taxation, then rates and council tax are the areas where there's the biggest ability to generate income and to influence behaviour.
Okay. Michael, to be followed by Liz.
Thanks, Convener. Can I start by declaring an interest of two immediate family members working in the Children and Family Service at Dundee City Council, which brings me to Mr Emmett. You talked about early years provision and the expansion in that and the number of people. But I mean, at the same time, the number of additional support needs teachers in Dundee has almost halved since 2010, so dropping from 165 to 93. That's in a context of teaching staff dropping across the board in Dundee, despite the number of pupils remaining roughly steady. It doesn't feel that strategic in terms of delivering better outcomes for kids from the most disadvantaged backgrounds.
So I think it's a challenge. I think you probably know that in terms of spend per head in schools, then Dundee's at the more efficient end of the scale. And I think that my colleagues in education would say if they had the resources, they'd want to see additional support going into schools. I think particularly since COVID, and you'll be aware, we've got additional resources on the back of that in terms of both teachers and people in the classroom assistants. The needs of young people have increased and the demand has increased. So the challenge for us, I suppose, is, and I suppose what I would say is the council recognises that as a priority area. We one of the areas we did explore in the budget for this year was whether or not we might look at teacher numbers, and we came away from that. So I think the council recognises the importance of that. I think there is a challenge in terms of the resourcing. So if you look at the envelope that we're working within and the resources we've got, I guess that's where we've got to. I think what the picture on staffing shows us, and I don't have the detail on ASN teachers that you've obviously got to hand, but that children and families has been valued at a higher rate than perhaps some of the environmental services. And I'm not surprised when you look at the figures that corporate services, for example, have been squeezed, because that's where I'd expect councils to be squeezing out efficiencies in terms of delivery of services. So I think it is a challenge. I think that there is a challenge, particularly across Scotland, I suppose, about how we get the best outcomes, how we invest.
Yeah.
And that's, I suppose, it's a policy matter rather than a...
Absolutely. And I suppose the purpose of this inquiry is really... So it's not my comment there is not necessarily to criticise on that issue. We could have that discussion elsewhere. I suppose my concern in this is about public sector reform and the process that's driven. And you've described that this is an outcome that is to be delivered by diktat the Scottish Government. They want to see a focus in this area. They want to see a focus on early years, as you described earlier on. But if at the same time you're cutting provision for the next stage, dramatically cutting provision for the most vulnerable children, and no sign of that recovering, that doesn't feel like a strategic approach to it. And I suppose it's you as a council have to respond to that instruction, but it doesn't feel like that's a strategic approach to public sector reform. I mean, that's a comment from me, but I don't know if you would reflect on that process.
I think the only thing to say, I suppose, is that what's important for us in the public sector is to be investing where our priorities are and recognising where that investment is. And I suppose I touched on taxation just before, but I think if we're going to have public services at the level that we want them, we have to think about how they are going to be funded and what the opportunities are to raise revenue to pay for the level of services that we wish. So if we wish to invest even more in early years because we think it's important, and prevention, which is important, and I am concerned that, you know, as we go forward, if we have to make more savings, it's going to eat into services which have a knock-on impact, then we have to think about how those are funded. So as a council, we'll be thinking about, you know, income and charges and what opportunities there are to raise funds to make sure we can still deliver services. But that's a bigger conversation. And I suppose my point about public sector reform is we can change the bodies. And I think, I suppose, Ian Tuff was talking about it before, is the efficiency around, and that's why I'm quoting our management figure about 1%, you're at the margins in merging organisations. How you deliver services on the ground and the people on the ground are what actually make the biggest difference.
Yeah.
And that's not to say that we can't do some of the work we are doing better. We know there are areas where there's always scope for improving some of those things, but some of that is a big policy question about the level of taxation and the level of public service, and we rightly should be under scrutiny that we're being efficient in what we are doing. But once you've got to a level where, you know, you've got the right number of people in the classroom, there's not a lot of leeway in terms of it further improving that.
Okay. You mentioned talked about changes to the number of children going into placements, which is a very expensive thing to do, young people being removed from their families and put into placements. If fewer of those children are put into those placements, will there be an increase in support in terms of the social workers working with those children if they are not put in? So when you're balancing that budget, hopefully reducing the cost on one side, are you seeing a linked increase in terms of the resource of social workers to work with those children when you're keeping them in house? I mean, that's something that must be a live discussion at the moment.
Absolutely. So what we are likely to have, there will be, so if you've compared with someone in a secure placement or something, then the cost of that provision locally will require investment. So it's not just about the cost, though. It's about that's likely to lead to better outcomes in the long term, retaining someone locally, but you've got to put the support in. So there's a couple of active discussions at the moment about different ways of providing that support and creating the capacity. So I know in my former council, we'd spend a lot of time creating local capacity so that there were alternatives to secure placement. So when you went to the children's panel, you weren't in a position where they were saying, well, the only thing we can do really here is it very expensive. Actually, there's a range of measures which might suit the circumstances of the individual and will deliver the outcomes that you want. Now, that's all very easy to say, but we've recently appointed a new member of staff who's working very hard to look at how can we put in a strategy which will deliver all of that. And I don't know all of the reasons for it. Dundee's costs in that area are disproportionately higher than many other councils, and you know, it's quite difficult to get to the bottom. That shouldn't be an excuse, but you know, there may well be specific circumstances that give rise to that.
Yeah. You mentioned, and colleagues mentioned, well, but I think it's the figure you brought forward, Mr. M, about 1% of costs being in terms of that executive function. I find some of the discussion about shared services like it's missing the point in some respects, in terms of it's a very small number at the top rather than the bulk of the cost that we're talking about. But has there been discussion in, for instance, across the Tayside region about a shared leadership team? So, for instance, a single chief executive, a single director of finance?
So we're having some of that discussion about what opportunities there might be around that. So that's, I would say, it's early days about thinking about what we could do and how might that work. I think there are challenges, particularly around the chief executive role, because of the support that's needed to councils from a political sense. But we certainly think there are opportunities to be explored there, and there may be things. But you're right, I think, to put your finger on this is one of the potential that might help. So that 1%, okay, if you can save a tenth of it, then you've made a contribution. But it's not going to be a panacea. It might just help. I think there's a bigger challenge about the number of bodies, which might be where you've got competing objectives and competing, you know, you're not all necessarily in the same space. So we've all got to be focused on the outcomes. And I think Ian described it better. We're saying if the partnership's working and you're all properly focused on the outcomes, then the barriers aren't there. You can remove the barriers. But sometimes the barriers do do pop up and make it more challenging to deliver services, when you, particularly when you've got different targets.
There was also mentioned, I think, in the evidence about the medium-term financial strategy published by the government. So the Institute for Fiscal Studies said that what that told us was there was a significant funding gap looming, but it gave little sense of how to address it. Fraser of Allender said the same, Spice said the same to this committee. What have you learned from that medium-term financial strategy as organisations about the challenges and the opportunities that are in front of you? Did it illuminate? Did it help? Ian Tuff?
It's probably a question for our Section 95 officer rather than myself, but what it has helped us do is develop our medium-term financial strategy aligned to that national position. So, you know, and it goes back to the point Mr. Lumsden made earlier as well about why have a medium-term financial strategy. And for us, a lot of the outcomes that we want to deliver for communities, you know, they are, you can't deliver them in a year. You need a longer-term period to be able to make a real impact. So I suppose it's an answer to both your questions is, you know, that's why you need that certainty or at least those projections with some certainty around them about where you can direct your resources to best meet those community outcomes, to best deliver services. So the having a national medium-term financial strategy helps that, but that one is just as open and as you know, part of the problem is there are so many movable parts within that as well. So there are so many variables within that national one as well as at a local position.
So that statement told us that there was a £1 billion funding gap in the coming year, and then rising within 3 years to £1.9 billion across Scotland between the projected policy prospectus of the government and what was to be delivered. So Malcolm Burt, does this just tell you the size of your black hole?
Yes, I think that's right. What it told us was it told us of the need for significant reform, and I think the point you made earlier about outcomes, it's a good argument for a single public authority in those areas which want one, because if your focus is, say, population retention and growth, what makes that happen? Jobs, skills, housing, looking after, you know, having a good service for children and young people. If the whole resource of the whole public sector in a locality can be devoted to that end without having to, let's say, negotiate the structural landscape and the priorities of each statutory body, which at a time of financial constraint, the tendency is always to retract and say, I have to do this and I don't have any capacity for that. It made the argument for significant public service reform very strongly. But as to the black hole, I think that's correct. It identified a gap which we know about and which we are all currently trying to fill through use of what reserves we have left and so-called deficiencies. Now, that cannot go on, and that's what the report said. There is a gap between expectation and statutory duty and financial reality, and we have to be more imaginative about how we address that, I think. Hence my plea for indicative budgets to at least allow us the space to work through these issues, which will require primary legislation. Hopefully in a local government's bill towards the end of this parliament. But that's not going to solve the next 3 to 4 years. So please let us have an environment which allows us to be creative as well as just managing.
Thank you, Camille.
OK, thank you. And Liz to be followed by Michelle.
Thank you. My question is the same question that I've asked two previous panels, and it relates to what I think is the fundamental tension at the heart of this, namely that there is this difficulty of trying to bring together the mandate situation that the Scottish Government would like to see across all public sector reform, namely their targets in place, against the targets that local councils set because they feel they are the best people to know the local circumstances. That's the central problem that we are grappling with. And I cited the example of the National Care Service because the Scottish Government, rightly, has said that the current system can't continue for all sorts of different reasons. But what the Scottish Government has proposed has, generally speaking, not been very well received by local councils. And I just wondered if you could comment on that, not on the politics of that, but on the difficulty of trying to bring the perspectives of national government together with those of local government to ensure that services are delivered in the best possible way. Namely, it's a challenge to bring your own perspectives together in the way that delivers better improvement.
Happy to try and answer that. I think that would be a good way forward. And I think back to 2007, I think, there was a concordat with local government and there was a local agreement between Scottish Government and each council. And I personally thought that was effective because it talked about what government legitimately wants, but also what local government as equally elected partner wanted and what could be delivered jointly. I think that's an approach that merits reconsideration because that is more than a local outcome impact assessment. That's really about saying we will do this in this area.
That's a helpful comment, Mr. Burke. Would you want that, let's say there was a new type of concordat, would you want that negotiated by government with each council or government with all 32 local authorities? How would you see the negotiation working to ensure that people in local government are satisfied that they are offering the best delivery?
I can see the advantage of a common approach across Scotland, but certainly locally it would be what matters. Well, one cannot presume ever what communities will want. I think back to our own budget consultation, which my colleague Robert Emmett led for us some 10 years ago or so. We thought we knew what the priorities would be within Lewis and Harris. The priority of the community was economic development. Within Uist, it was community transport so that people could have the freedom to move around, to access services in what's a very sparsely populated community. That's, one shouldn't presume. So I think that local engagement about how government of course has its outcomes and rightly so, but how are these best delivered in our area will be very different, genuinely very different to elsewhere. How I could give housing as an example, which is both positive and which is a really positive thing, which could be delivered better, but that local agreement I think is absolutely essential, and it gives the parity of esteem between the two parts of elected government in Scotland, which the Scotland Act envisaged all these years ago.
Mr. Tough and Mr. Emmett, would you like to see that as well?
Yeah, I think that common approach would be helpful, but still having room for that localism, for reflecting what are the priorities locally. If I think again, and they touched on Police Scotland a couple of times today, so they have those national strategic priorities, but at a local level, each local authority is required to have a local police plan, which reflects your local priorities. So I think it's a similar approach that we could get to. The National Performance Framework, for instance, again, is something that we cite all the time and that we want to align to, but only where it's things that are important to us at a local level, and you can see those connections. So things that are in our local outcomes improvement plan, okay, it's a nod towards what the National Performance Framework is, but it's still very much dominated by what are the local issues for us. So yes, I think that approach is proven to work already.
I suppose just to add, I'm thoughtful about where decision making is made and it being made at the right level, and I don't think we've always got it right. But who should be making the decision about how resources are deployed in a school? Should it be the head teacher? Should it be the local authority? Should it be the national government? And actually deciding, you know, whether you need a teacher or whether you need to buy a resource or whether you need a psychologist. those are decisions that, where is it right to make those decisions? So there are some decisions clearly that should be made at a local level and other ones that should be considered at a national level. And there are some policies where we wouldn't want 32 national ways of doing different things. So I think any framework, we shouldn't be afraid to be having that conversation of who should be making this decision. And at a national level, you should be saying that's a matter for the local council on which they stand and fall, or they should be saying, no, that the policy on income tax is a national policy, that's a matter for the parliament. And that, perhaps just some conversation around which things sit where and who is accountable for them would help us in terms of driving forward. We can make difficult decisions sometimes, and they're best to be left to be accountable for at a local level. If you're rationalising schools, for example, that can be a difficult, painful process. Very few people would go back 10 years and say, oh, I wish we hadn't closed those two old schools and built a brand new one. Mm. So, but that would have been a difficult discussion at the time, but actually one for the local politicians, and if it wasn't popular, then they wouldn't get back in. And that's the reality of democracy.
Thank you very much.
It's hard not to get back in sometimes when you've got multi-member wards. Michelle.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us. I'm going to come to you, Robert, first, because you're the only person that's mentioned this word thus far, and that's AI. Obviously, such is the speed, the exponential growth and use of AI, change is likely to be foisted on both local councils and indeed on the Scottish Government, and we know that. So in terms of thinking how AI can assist public sector reform and indeed the general provisioning of your services, what active consideration are you giving to it thus far and your approach? And if I can come to you first, and I appreciate it's a slightly different question for yourself, Malcolm, but obviously being the home really leading light in terms of Abertay University, if you could give us a flavour.
So I'm happy to do that. At this stage, the main area we've been looking at is around customer services and our interaction with the public, and it gives rise to a whole host of things, not least the ethics around how you're using AI in decision making. And I know there's been some discussion around that. We were actually doing work with a leading business looking at this, and one of the things, for example, they were struggling with was understanding the local dialect. I'm hoping we'll get past that, but I think the pace of it is probably faster than, if I'm honest, we have been moving at this stage. So if you think about the developments in the course just of 2023, they have probably outpaced most people who are looking at and thinking about how we can use this. So I think about our ability to respond efficiently and effectively to customers ought to become better. Our ability to join up the pieces of customer inquiries ought to become better, because if you've got access to the data and you've got access to the processing power, I think it's untapped, I suppose, would be my short answer. But also we need to be careful with it, because I think it does open up lots of doors around, as I said, ethics and around data protection and various things. And also the risk that it'll go off in completely the wrong direction in terms of how it might respond to people. But I also think, and I've been having this conversation with our Executive Director of Children and Families, around where does it sit in education? So it's, I know it's a challenge in terms of, is this your own work? Type of situation, if you're getting someone to write an essay, get a computer to write your essay for you. But also, does it not help us with what about learning language? What about access to information? What about marking the work? You know, how can we tap into that? So I think there's something there. I suppose I'm not qualified enough to know how revolutionary it will be, but there must be opportunities around that. But we need to tackle with them care. With mm-hmm. care at this stage would be my sense. Maybe in a year's time I'll have a more better understanding of how we can do something.
And a follow-on to that, one of the critical enablers for its utilisation is sound collection of data, and I fully accept what you're saying about how you use that data ethically. How aware are you of that as an enabler, as a council? Because obviously you're mentioning customer services at the moment, that's almost like the kind of wrong way around, because the whole point about AI is it's going to blow up a lot of our, like, it's driven by process, the functions that we've developed, it's going to break all that asunder. So how actively focused are you on collecting data as a minimum, given the massive kind of processing power that AI can utilise off the back of that?
It's an active conversation for us at the moment, because we're mindful that different parts of the council's working in different ways with data, and we're trying to look at how we can bring that together. So we're conscious we have a huge amount of data. I don't think we always make the best use of it. Sometimes it's sitting there and we're not looking at it. And I think when it comes to decisions about what services we have in the future and who's using those services and what are their needs, they're really important. So I'm thoughtful about, you know, do we understand the impacts of changes we're making in services? Who are the people who would be impacted by the change of the services? And I think we have a lot of information. There's a huge amount of data about school performance, around attendance at facilities, you know, and around council tax and all those sorts of things. So using it carefully, sometimes it's a hindrance. So we've got loads and loads of data and we're not using it effectively. Another time, because we're really careful about following the law and making sure we're doing absolutely everything right. And sometimes we're too cautious. So I think, again, I think there are opportunities that we're not capturing, and also making sure it's evidence-based decisions that we are following. And you'll know yourselves that sometimes people can become quite passionate about something and can lose sight of the facts. So the value of a service is not always underpinned by the number of people using that service or the value of that service to them. So decisions, I think, particularly when they're difficult, need to be evidenced. And that's where that comes in. I'm hopeful that it might be able to take the legwork out. So if you could be confident you can ask AI a question and it'll come back and give you all of the answers and you can believe them, then have you saved yourself a day's work? Can I, you know, I haven't tried it, but can I get it to write my budget strategy for me? And what will it be suggesting? So and it might uncover something I haven't thought about, because it might say, wow, well, actually, if you looked at what they're doing in Coronel and Young and Shear, you might pick up something that's been done differently. So it's got applications. I don't think we even know what questions to ask it yet, if I'm on it. Well, I certainly don't. Maybe you're ahead of me.
If I can bring in yourself, Ian and Malcolm, and then I've just got a follow-up question from that.
Yeah, so I did ask it a question recently, and it was, can you provide me with a job outline for an AI researcher? And it produced me a perfect job outline and advert that I could go out and use. So it has practical uses, but I think Robert's absolutely right. The pace of change with AI is something that we've not caught up with, certainly where I work. And I think we need to understand what it can do, but we also need to understand what the risks of it are as well. And I think your comment about the management of the information that it provides, the governance around that information, whether it's GDPR or whatever, I think we need to understand that better. So that's a journey we're on just now. So having used it once and got a great result, I think there's something in it for us, but we need to understand it better.
Yeah. And so are you taking any active steps to develop a strategy or the research that will help frame a strategy? And I'm thinking again specifically about how it might be utilised in public sector reform, which is all future focus. Where are you in terms of developing your knowledge as a council?
Once I get someone appointed to that position, that, right, I just got the job description written for, yeah, then that's the approach. But it's very much one of the emerging issues within our digital strategy. I know I've mentioned that a couple of times today, but it is a priority area for us to look at. Yeah.
Malcolm, I appreciate the scales are markedly different for you. I do understand that.
Yes, we will primarily work through Solace and other, the Improvement Service and other agencies in developing our own strategy there. But it has changed what was thought of as digitalisation. And I think the question we always have to ask is, how does it empower and who does it empower? That's my test for new technology such as that. The lawyer side of me always says, it's how safe is the evidence? But I think Ian Turf has given a very good example of what it can do in terms of time saving. It has that evidence base, and provided it is something neutral to which, let's say, human beings can apply their critical faculties, I think it is part of a digital efficiency strategy. But we have to ask, How does it empower people? In principle, it should empower the less articulate, the less able to participate more. But will it? I don't know. So it's very much it's exciting. We shouldn't see it as a threat. We should see it, I think, as something to be managed and be wary of in its negative aspects. But it's like all technology; it usually has more benefits than disbenefits.
And a general question for you all then, in terms of what sort of guidance in terms of public sector reform to ensure that you include that? Are you receiving from the Scottish Government? Grasping a sense of urgency from the Scottish Government that this is something that you need to be looking at? Have any conversations taken place? Ian, you've blinked.
I'm not aware of any, as Malcolm as Malcolm mentioned, I think where we have seen some advice and guidance is through our professional networks, through COSLA Improvement Service, etc. I'm not close enough to what's perhaps coming emerging nationally, Scottish Government, but certainly our professional networks are very much looking at where there are opportunities for this.
Yeah. Is that the same for both?
Apologies, were you just talking about AI?
Yes.
Yeah, so again, at a national level, so we're working with COSLA, but it's a fast-moving space. And I think there's still a bit of catching up going on.
Okay, right.
I would say it is ripe for national and local collaboration across the whole public sector on this, because the issues are largely the same.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Michelle. That appears to have included questions from the committee. Are there any further points each of you would like to make before we conclude the session? Not at all.
Just a final word, perhaps, about public service reform, just in case. I don't think anyone in the questions have been very illuminating, but just in case it is thought it is largely about governance or local government, it's about empowerment, improvement, and I would say sustaining public service.
Thank you, Mr. Emmett. You any comments you want to make? Okay. Well, thank you very much for your evidence this morning. That was very helpful to the committee. We will continue taking evidence after the summer recess. As that concludes our public evidence taking today, the next item on our agenda will be in private, so I will call a 5-minute recess in order to allow the official report and our witnesses to leave. Thank you.